If you have come today seeking refuge from the flurry of holiday busyness, God welcomes you into His presence. Are you longing for a peace in a chaotic world, yearning for a lasting joy, hoping to find a place of rest from all your full calendars and hectic schedules? God welcomes you into His presence. So come and taste the bread of life, drink the cup of blessing, hear the message of Advent hope. God welcomes you into His house, provides for you a place at His table. He sets you free from all of your worries and makes all things new. So let us worship Him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength as we go to Him in prayer. Lord, this is a time of waiting and spiritual preparation, and the truth is, we're really not all that good at either one of those. And all too often, these get shoved aside in favor of our zinging hither and yon, trying to get all of our to-do lists finished. Can the quiet joy of Advent even begin to compete with the conspicuous consumption that's such a large part of how we celebrate your birth? Does that voice crying in the wilderness stand a chance of even being heard over all the noise and the commotion? As we worship today, speak to us. Speak tenderly, but speak insistently. Let the sacredness of the space and hour hold us fast so that we might have peace, that we might be forever changed. Speak to the deepest yearnings of our hearts, for it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Greetings and welcome to our time of worship here at Hickory Ridge United Methodist Church. I am your host, Preacher Bob. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we seek to worship in spirit, in truth, in all humility. Whether this is the first time that you've tuned into one of our podcasts or you're a regular, we're thankful for your presence. We hope that you receive something from our broadcast that gives you a blessing that you can take with you as you journey through the rest of your week. All of our podcasts are archived and they're available on demand, online, on our YouTube channel. Just simply log on to YouTube. At the top of the page, type altered states into the search dialog box. That's A-L-T-A-R-E-D, altered states. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel and ring that notify bell icon so that you can know whenever we post new material. In addition to our worship podcast, we offer daily devotions and meditations each weekday entitled As a Matter of Faith. These very brief and thought-provoking messages can only be found on our Facebook page. So go to Facebook, search for Hickory Ridge United Methodist Church, Hickory Ridge UMC. That's one word, Hickory Ridge UMC. Check us out and start your day with a little inspiration and encouragement. We don't live in a culture that gives us the tools for us to wait very well. In fact, just the opposite is true. We live in a culture that worships instant gratification, primes us to expect solutions to all of our problems within 30 minutes or an hour. We live in a world where we can order just about anything we want off of Amazon and find it on our doorstep within 24 hours. It's a world where I can send a text, a photograph, an email message, or anything like that across the ocean and almost have it arrive instantaneously. It's a world where we have 24/7 access to information and healthcare and nourishment and shelter. In a cultural economy like this, delays are seen as a waste of time. And worst of all, they are reasons for us to even doubt the love and the goodness of God. And yet, as I go through and study the scriptures, one of the things I find is that waiting not only is the norm, it's almost our vocation as Christians. Now, normally when we wait, that leads to a kind of nervous apprehension. We're expecting that something spectacular is about to happen, but the kind of waiting that we do at Advent is one that leads to a growth of inner stillness and joy that leads us to realize that the one that we've been waiting for is actually already here. And He's trying to speak to us in the silence of our hearts. So as we prepare to make room in our hearts for Christ to dwell within us, we acknowledge our own sin, which stands in the way of living the full life that God has promised us through Christ. So let us be truthful with God, honest, in the presence of one another. Let us give God the gift of our honest and humble confession. Loving Lord, Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. We have been lukewarm disciples. We've lacked the zeal of John the Baptist. Instead of letting our voices cry in the wilderness, our voices have been weak and half-hearted. Instead of proclaiming our gospel with conviction, we've shrugged and stammered. Instead of clothing ourselves in humility and faith, we've put on power and prestige. Instead of giving you the glory, we have puffed ourselves up with pride. Forgive us, O God. Transform us for authentic and wholesome discipleship. In Jesus' name. My children, you were once enslaved and in bondage to the power of sin, and there was no escape for you. But then Jesus Christ came along and he liberated you from your bondage, and he removed everything that diminishes his image that is within you. This is the good Advent news. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, your sins are forgiven. Jesus Christ sits at the right hand of the Father and intercedes on our behalf. Following his example, our mission is the church. Our task, our function, is to intercede on behalf of those who are in our church, who are in our community, whether that is a physical community or a virtual community, all of those who are weary or overburdened with hardships and difficulties. We would like very much to pray for you and with you. And so if you have a need, if there's a concern that you have that you'd like to have prayed over, then if you would just send that request via email to preacher.bob@aol.com, preacher.bob@aol.com, we would be more than happy to lift that request up as we lift up our others. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Compassionate God, in this time of darkness, we wait for that one that will come and redeem us. As we revel in all the merriment of the season, the sparkle of all the decorations, we need to remember that there are a lot of folks for whom this holiday is not one of joy and good cheer. And so today we pray for those who can't see the light in the darkness. Pray that they would find hope not in the commercial side of Christmas, but rather in the promise of the Christ child. We pray for those who are grieving the very first time for this Advent season, fearing what it's like this holiday after losing someone that was close to them. May they know your comfort and hope in the promise of your resurrection. We pray for those who struggle to feel joy because the life circumstances, they're mired in mounting bills. They despair for lack of employment. We pray, Lord, that you would give them the faith to know that you would provide. We pray for our military families who are separated by tremendous distances from their loved ones, whose tables will have an empty seat this Christmas. May they rely on you for their strength and protection. And we pray for those whose family dynamics make holidays not a time of joy and festivity, but rather one of stress and anger. We pray that through your grace that hearts can be softened, old hurts can be released, that a door somehow can be opened to reconciliation. So Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We lift our joys, we give over our concerns, those that we have spoken, those that rest within our hearts, we give those over to the tender care of your Son, who taught us how we are to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. When God created the earth and all that's in it, he placed the crowning portion of his creation, which is we humans, believe it or not, he appointed us to have dominion over it. And so in exchange for this faithful stewardship, God has allowed us to glean from creation those things we need for our own sustenance. It is with tremendous gratitude and thanksgiving that we return to God a part of that with which he has so richly blessed us and all of creation. In this time of pandemic, when health concerns have limited much of what we do, the ministries of the church and the needs that those ministries address, well, they continue. We are thankful for the support that you have shown these ministries in the past. We are thankful for the way that you support in the present, and we pray that you would continue to be generous even into the future. Let us pray. God, because we've been given so much, we pray that you would help us to give more. Because we've been loved so much, give us the strength to love more. Because we've been accepted as we are with all of our warts, bumps, and wrinkles, we ask that you'd give us the grace to accept others without any prejudice or any judgment. We gladly give of our finances, our time, our energy, and hopes that you would multiply their usefulness in your kingdom. For it is in Jesus' name and his sake that we pray. Amen. As we begin to study the scriptures this morning, we look first at this passage from the Old Testament, from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak softly and tenderly to Jerusalem, but also make it very clear that she has served her sentence, that her sin is taken care of. It's forgiven. She's been punished enough and more than enough, and now it's over and done with. So thunder in the desert. Prepare for the arrival of God. Make that road straight and smooth, a highway fit for our God. Fill in those valleys, level off the hills, smooth out the ruts, clear out all the rocks. The God's bright glory will shine and everyone will see it. Just as God has said. A voice says, shout, and I say, what shall I shout? These people are nothing but grass. Their love is fragile as wildflowers. The grass withers, the wildflowers fade. If God so much as puffs on them, aren't these people just so much grass? True, the grass withers and the wildflowers fade, but our God's word stands firm and forever. So go climb a mountain, Zion. You're the preacher of good news. Raise your voice. Make it good, loud, and clear, Jerusalem. You are the preacher of good news. Speak loud and clear. Don't be timid. Tell the cities of Judah, look at God. Look at him. Your master comes in power, ready to go in action. And he's going to pay back his enemies and reward those who have loved him. Like a shepherd, he will take care of the flock, gathering the lambs in his arms, hugging them as he carries them, leading them to good pasture. Our second reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. The good news of Jesus Christ, the message, starts here, following to the letter, the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. Watch closely. I am sending my preacher ahead of you, and he'll make that road smooth for you. Thunder in the desert, prepare for the arrival of God. Make that road smooth and straight. John the Baptizer appeared in the wild, preaching a baptism of life change that leads to the forgiveness of sin. People came to him from all over Judea and Jerusalem, and as they confessed their sins, they were baptized in the Jordan River by him into a changed life. Old John, he wore a camel hair habit, tied it at the waist with a leather belt, ate locusts and field honey. And as he preached, he said, the real action, boys and girls, comes next. The star in this drama, to whom I'm just a stagehand, is going to rock your world. I am baptizing you here in this river, turning that old life of yours into a kingdom life. But his baptism, holy baptism, won by the Holy Spirit, will change you from the inside out. Let us pray. Now, gracious God, as we turn to your word for us, we ask that your spirit would rest upon us. Help us to be steadfast in the way that we hear, in the way that we speak, in the way that we believe, in the way we live. For we ask it in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The text I'm going to use this morning as a kind of linchpin or pivot point for our message is from 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 15. Now, don't overlook the obvious here, friends. With God, one day is good as 1,000 years, 1,000 years like a day. God's not late with his promise like some folks measure lateness. See, he's restraining himself on account of you, holding back the end because he didn't want anybody to be lost. He's giving everybody space and time to change. But now when that day of judgment does come, it's going to come unannounced like a thief. The sky is going to collapse with a thunderous bang, everything disintegrating in a huge conflagration, earth and all its works exposed to the scrutiny of judgment. And since everything might be here today and gone tomorrow, do you see how essential it is for you to live a holy life? Daily expect the day of God, eager for its arrival. The galaxies are going to burn up, elements will melt down that day, but you know what? We ain't even going to notice it. We're going to be looking the other way, ready for that promised new heaven and that promised new earth, all landscaped with righteousness. So friends, since this is what you're looking forward to, do your very best to be found living at your best, in purity and peace. Interpret the Master's patient restraint for what it is, salvation. Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's say, just for grins and giggles, that you need to call customer service. So you get your smartphone and you tap that number out and you wait. And you wait. And you wait. And finally there's a voice. And before you realize it, you begin speaking only to come to find out it's not a real person. It's a recording. And that recording is very graciously telling you, thank you for your call. It is important to us. Please pay attention to these new menu options, as many of them have changed. And so they proceed to go down this list of about 300 menu options, and you listen very intently, trying to figure out which one that you are going to choose. The trick is that it really doesn't make any difference how closely you listen to those menu options. What you really need is not one in one of those options. And the one that you actually do choose inevitably is going to take you to another recording that says all of our operators are busy at the moment. Your call is going to be answered in the order in which it was received. And then it's when you realize that you have been assigned to call waiting hell. Or let's say that you go to the doctor's office. You've got an appointment at 2:00. And when you get there, there's already 30 people sitting in the waiting room. And you know what? Every single one of them have got an appointment with your doctor at 2:00. And so you're kind of confined to that antiseptic, boring waiting room while you peruse all those hopelessly outdated magazines. And then finally and mercifully, the nurse comes and ushers you back to the exam room where you wait more. Only this time, there's no magazines to look at, and you start going through all the drawers and cabinets that are in the little room just to kill the time. It's no wonder they call us patients. As Tom Petty sang, waiting is the hardest part. Now, today, we've got all kind of entertainment options at our fingertips that'll keep us occupied while we wait. When we go pump gas. There's a little TV screen on your gas pump that will show you a little commercial or a song and dance or a dog and pony show, something to keep you entertained in those few moments while you might be pumping gas. But having said all that, I have to admit that despite all the technology that we might have, waiting is still hard to do. And it seems like waiting is sometimes all that we do. We wait at airports, we wait in waiting rooms, we wait in traffic, we wait at the post office, we wait at the bank, we wait to speak to a real, live, honest-to-goodness, no-kidding, breathing human being when we call customer support. We wait, and we wait, and our patience starts to run thin. But, you know, I have found that if you do a little bit of planning ahead, you can make your waiting time more productive, and maybe even, if you're lucky, make it fun. For one thing, you can strike up a conversation with the person that's sitting close to you, you know, sort of learn their story and share yours with them. Or if that's not suitable for you, you can take your smartphone and go through all your unread emails. Nobody likes to do that, but it's a pretty good way to kill time. Or you can cull through your phone's picture gallery and get rid of the ones that you decide you don't want. Or if you get to feeling real froggy, You can while away your time by seeing how close you can hold your finger to the person sitting beside you without actually touching them. You know, like you used to do to your sibling in the car, "I'm not touching you." Or while you're waiting in line, you can pretend to be somebody's shadow. You know, move like they move. If you're waiting in a doctor's office, then sit there and play the game of trying to guess the disease of every other person who's there. It's not going to do anything to shorten the amount of time that you're going to have to wait, but you know what? You can make it fun. But what if that wait time is going to be really long, like, you know, let's say a couple of thousand years? See, that's the dilemma that's facing the early church after Jesus ascends into heaven. He had promised his disciples he's going to return, and a lot of folks in the church believe that that return was going to be imminent, you know, kind of like yesterday. In fact, some of the Christians in the church there at Thessalonica, they thought Jesus was going to come and like so quickly that they quit all their jobs and just sat around all day on the porch drinking iced tea waiting for Jesus to come. And that's what prompted Paul to issue that famous line, "Those folks what don't work don't eat." But now enough time has passed that folks are beginning to wonder just how Jesus would define that word soon. Persecution of the church was getting worse. Waiting was becoming the hardest part of being a Christian. In fact, some people were even beginning to wonder whether Jesus was going to come back at all. And that's really kind of the issue that the writer of 2 Peter addresses. This letter, which is kind of a follow-up to the first letter that bears the name of Peter, reads more like a theological instruction manual than a typical letter. And there's a good reason for that. You see, in the first letter, the writer is talking to the church, which is being pressured by forces from the outside. But in this second letter, he's talking about problems that have come up from inside the church, from internal sources. And specifically, that has to do with all of the false teachers who were skeptical that Jesus was going to return. And because they were skeptics, they were encouraging looser ethical and moral behavior. I mean, if Jesus ain't coming back, why does it really matter how you behave? And so the writer of the letter is reminding the church that Jesus will, absolutely, no kidding, indeed, without a doubt, come back just like he promised. And when he comes back, he's going to bring justice and abolish evil. It's going to usher in a brand new creation. And the way that those Christians behave, how they conduct themselves while they're waiting, is going to have some serious implications on what their eternity is going to be like. So waiting is the hardest part. And the writer of this letter understands that. Now the twist in all this is that what seems like a really slow waiting period for Christ to come back is actually a blessing in disguise. It's actually a gift from God. As the writer says, God is not late with his promise like a lot of folks measure lateness. He's just restraining himself, and because of you, holding back the end because he don't want nobody to be lost. He's giving everybody a chance and space to change. But when that day of God's judgment does come, it's going to come unannounced like a thief. The sky's going to collapse with a thunderous bang, everything disintegrating into a huge conflagration, earth and all its works exposed to the scrutiny of judgment. In the interim, and it might just be a really, really long interim, as God's divine plan is kind of being played out beyond what we can see and what we can know, what kind of lives is it that we should be living? A new heaven, a new earth are coming, all landscape with righteousness, as the writer says. So what should we be doing while we wait? Well, the short answer is that those who are followers of Christ should begin living the righteous life that is in accordance with that new creation as if it were happening right now. Now, for sure, there's going to be a period of waiting, but it's not to be a passive one, which we, like those disciples at the Ascension, were just kind of staring off into heaven waiting for Jesus to come back. We recognize that there's work to do, that there are things we need to strive for, things that we need to do while we are waiting. So if we look at 2 Peter as a whole, we discover that there are five things that we can and most probably must do while we're waiting for that new Advent. The first thing is that we remember the promise of the first Advent. See, this letter opens with a reminder of the faith that these individuals received through the righteousness of God and their Savior Jesus Christ. Now, that's a very powerful witness of the incarnation. Jesus is both God and Savior. Say that again. Jesus is both God and Savior at one and the same time. Now, if you think that's you trying to wrap your head around that, just figure how Peter and the disciples, they were eyewitnesses to this very incarnation of God when they were up on that mountain with him there at the Transfiguration. They heard that voice coming out of the cloud, says, "This is my Son, my beloved, in whom I'm well pleased." So as we celebrate this season of Advent, it's a chance for us to remember again that God has come to us in person, in Christ, and in so doing has confirmed the truthfulness of all his promises for us. The Lord for whom we wait is always true to his word. The second thing is to grow in the image of Christ. When Jesus returns, the writer of 2 Peter urges the readers to do your very best to be found living at your very best, in purity, in peace. In fact, this is how we were supposed to be living from the very beginning, from when we were created in the image of God. The corruption that we experienced, well, that was the result of our sin, not because of what Jesus had done in his life. Jesus saved us from all that. It was his death, his resurrection, his ascension, that once again made us participants in his divine nature. And so the writer is urging us to make every effort to support our faith through acts of virtue and goodness, knowledge, self-control, endurance, godliness, mutual affection, love, all of these commodities that are in short supply today. Focusing on these things will keep you from being ineffective and unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, let me interpret that in layman's terms. That means, essentially, don't be a stupid, hypocritical Christian. That's what the writer of 2 Peter means by admonishing Christians to live lives that are holy and godly. When you are in doubt as how you are to live, you don't read Cosmopolitan or GQ, or you don't watch Fox News, or you don't watch any other program. You just live a life that looks like Jesus. Third, dig deep into the scriptures. Now, Peter and the other disciples, can you imagine how they must have watched in awe as the scriptures, the promises of the scriptures, they saw them being fulfilled right at the very moment. They actually saw all those prophecies of Jesus the Messiah coming to be fulfilled. So the writer encourages the readers to dig deep into the scriptures to pay attention to what those scriptures say. You see, when we read the scriptures, what we discover is that the message about Jesus wasn't one of human origin. It came to us through men and women who spoke moved by the Holy Spirit. So if we immerse ourselves daily in the scriptures, and I can't emphasize this enough, if we spend time daily in the scriptures, read the scriptures personally, read them in community in the church, that helps keep us from having interpretations that just simply validate our own agendas or operate as a kind of a shield that blocks out any destructive opinions that might jump over the wall into the church. You know, opinions, kind of like certain body parts, everybody got them. Especially in this 24-hour news cycle environment where every expert and pundit and politician spends half their time giving you their never humble opinion and the other half explaining why they got it all wrong. In a world that can't wait to be overloaded with their brains and their phones with information and opinions, Scripture calls us to come back to the truth of God that is revealed to us by those who were inspired by the Holy Spirit. We have to always be ready to compare the words of others to the words that come from the Word of God. As the writer of 2 Peter puts it, you should remember the words spoken in the past by the prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior that was spoken through your apostles. When we make a habit of daily engaging ourselves in with the scriptures. We galvanize our memory of the Word of God, and it makes us able to more consistently live the Christian life every day. Fourth, pay attention to what it is that masters you. Now, this text begins by criticizing what the writer calls false teachers. They promise freedom, but they're actually slaves of corruption. And then he makes one kind of spot-on pinpoint observation that was true then, and it's just as true today. People are slaves to whatever masters them. So as you move through the Advent season, that's a pretty good question to form the basis of your quest for Christmas. What is it that masters you? I mean, really? I mean, is it money? Sex? Power? Maybe it's something else altogether? As that great theologian Bob Dylan used to sing, it may be the devil, it may be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody. So who are you serving? Fifth, use your time wisely. Interpret our master's patient restraint for what it is, salvation. In this in-between time, as we wait for Jesus to return, we have the opportunity to use that time that God has given us to share the faith with others. Peter, like the Apostle Paul, spent almost every waking hour trying to find ways to share the good news about Jesus Christ with everybody they met. And they did it with a sense of urgency because they just knew that Jesus could return at any moment. Now, according to this text, the writer admits that sometimes Paul's writings were hard to understand, and so that made them kind of vulnerable to being twisted and distorted by folks who were, well, they're just ignorant and insidious and just twisted the words to suit their own fancy, but they were powerful words nonetheless because they were designed to impact others with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Disciples of Jesus Christ recognize that God has given us the time to spread the word about Jesus, and we need to use that time wisely. Those conversations that we have with folks in waiting rooms or while standing in line or pretending to be their shadow, these are all opportunities to have spiritual conversations, listening to the leading of the Spirit. As the writer says in the first letter, always be ready to make your defense to anybody who demands from you an accounting of the hope that is in you. Now, I'm going to be honest. I am an impatient, restless person. Slowing down and waiting, to me, seems like a waste of time. If there's something that needs doing, you don't talk about it. It just gets done. Yet, waiting seems to be part of the human condition. Waiting seems to be most of what we do. But waiting can be a period of learning. The longer we wait, the more we learn about Christ for whom we're waiting. And that sentiment resonates with what Paul says in Romans. He says, waiting does not diminish us any more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother. We are rather enlarged in waiting. You see, it's during these times of waiting that God really is sort of vibrantly working within us. That waiting might just be the hardest part of being a Christian, but it's also probably one of the most important parts. God has given us the tools and the time to bring the good news to the world in anticipation of the second advent. So let's wait. And let's wait well. Let us pray. Christ, you've told us you're present whenever God's children are in trouble or sorrow or pain. And we find it easy to see you in lepers and beggars in ancient Palestine. But we need you to help us see you in the aches and pains and diseases of our own cities and towns. Forgive us for wanting to keep you back in ancient Palestine. Remind us that you're here in the midst of the heartache of today and that we really can find you today right in the middle of it all. Give us the ability and the vision to see you in everyone, even the sick, the lonely, the rich, the poor, people of every color, and dare we even say those that we don't know or don't like. Help us to follow your word In Jesus' name, amen. My children, you have waited, but soon you will not wait anymore. The celebration of the birth of Christ is almost here. May your time with friends and family be sweet. May the memories that you make be unforgettable, for these are the moments in which you see Christ, so don't miss him. Don't forget him. Welcome him into your home and your lives as you eat and drink and share gifts. As you leave here today, go in joy, go in hope, go in peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.